Hello everyone, and welcome to Chapter 2 of my Resident Evil 6 No Hope, No Damage playthrough. And let's get ready to tackle Chapter 2. What is happening right now? Okay. Almost forgot to say that this playthrough is co-op as well. Again, with my sister, Vanessa Kanoichi. So we are on a falling bus. Let's take out some zombies, make sure not to get damaged. Again, I don't think my sister cares about being damaged. But, I'm trying to do this no damage. So, again, I'm not sure if it is possible to do in this game. But, we will see. And hopefully it is.
Whatever reason, we're still alive.
But, I was like trying to be silent during the cutscenes, but it doesn't really matter because I'm not leaving the cutscenes in. Or the, silent during the dialogue, rather. But, so as I said, I'm not sure if it is possible to complete Leon's campaign without being damaged. But, we will find out. I'm sure we'll find out sometime. Hopefully it is possible, though. I'm really hoping that it is. But there are plenty of places in the other campaigns where you're essentially forced to be damaged, so I just can't remember off the top of my head if it's like that for Leon or not, so. But in any case, we did do Chapter 1 without taking damage, and that chapter will be linked in the description just in case you did not see it and you're wondering what is going on and when did this no damage playthrough start. I started this quite a while back, but then a lot of things happened, so I wasn't able to continue it until now. And right now I'm out of stamina, so that's always great. But this section you want to be careful because, as you just saw, like when the lightning struck right there, the zombies just appeared out of nowhere. They just automatically spawned. And wow, that was close. But there are a few places where zombies just continuously spawn in this game, and you just have to wait it out and kind of tackle wave after wave of enemies. At least in Leon's campaign. I was going to say Camping. But yeah, this spot can be a little annoying. But whenever the zombies lunge at you like that, it is best to do a dodge roll or something like that rather than doing a quick shot like I did. The quick shot usually works, but every so often the zombies just completely ignore it and lunge at you anyway, which is really annoying in this game. Zombies just completely ignoring damage, especially from the shotgun. It just does not make any sense. I've seen zombies ignore damage from magnums as well. It's absolutely crazy. They should have done a better job with that kind of thing. I really hate it in games when, you know, you shoot enemies and stuff like that and they just aren't affected at all. I don't mind that for like really large enemies, but when it's just a basic zombie that's not affected by anything, there is a problem. Jesus Christ, there is. And you can shoot them from like point blank range and they won't even move. It's just ridiculous. But, in any case, we are searching for a key. So let's see if the key is in here. Okay, apparently it's not. And, of course, that doesn't count as damage. So, Leon was actually hit, but he wasn't damaged, which is nice.
I guess there are worse things than chasing a dog through a cemetery.
Okay, so now we have to chase down the dog in order to get the key to get out of the cemetery. And just waiting for her. I think she's fighting something. Yep. Alright, let's go back. I think she took down a few, actually. Some ammo here. Alright. Now let's try to take down that dog. So this section is a little hazardous. Again, zombies will spawn in a variety of areas during this section. There are also zombie dogs. Zombie dogs are kind of annoying. Again, they have the same little quirk that the zombies have, wherein they completely ignore certain damage, are infected whatsoever, and that is really close. Stay away from me, please. Jesus. Okay.
Good work.
But for the most part, the sniper rifle is pretty good at damaging things. When you do quick shots, I really hate it when you do quick shots and enemies just aren't affected. Again, the shotgun is one of the main culprits of that. Like, you can be standing right next to a zombie, quick shot him, and he'll just keep coming at you. It's just absolutely ridiculous. But yeah, with the sniper rifle, it seems to be pretty good. Alright, so once you go down there, like, if you were to run down there as opposed to sniping him like I was, a bunch of zombies would spawn. But yeah, I think they may or may not have spawned, I'm not sure right now. Yep, they did. But I think you get surrounded here, actually, if you just run down here after the dog. But it's best it's best to just focus on that dog. Because, yeah. But so far, so good.
Now let's get to that cathedral.
So, I really like this little graveyard section. Just the way it looks and everything. There's a lot of stuff in Leon's campaign that's very reminiscent to the older games, but it's just the... I don't know. I wish the game mechanics themselves were more refined, again, with the zombies not taking... or not being affected by bullets and stuff like that. In the older games, pretty much everything is affected. You know, it doesn't matter how large the enemy is, if you hit them in their weak spot, or if you hit them, you know, two or three times, if they're a larger enemy, they'll be staggered a little bit, okay, and stuff like that. But in this game, it's just really strange. Later on in this chapter... Oh, jeez. Hold on a sec. Okay, sorry about that. Someone was calling me, but yeah. As I was saying, later on in this chapter, you come across this like bulbous thing that spews this miasma in the air. It's just those enemies are just so strange because they just aren't staggered really at all by anything. Like, you can blast them constantly with a magnum and nothing at all. They just refuse to be staggered. It is jarring as all hell. Like, you would think that would be an enemy that was easily damaged because of how bulbous it is, but it doesn't even matter. It's not like this guy where, you know, you shoot him in his giant pink thing or whatever that is. His giant pink neck, and he just goes down quickly. No, that's a well done enemy. Like, if you don't hit him in a certain spot, then he'll go down pretty quickly. Or take a little bit to go down as opposed to going down quickly if you shoot them in the right spot. But a lot of the other enemies just aren't affected by things. And again, one of my main complaints about this game is just enemies just aren't affected by things. And if they are affected, they kind of cheat their way through it, especially in stuff like Jake and Chris's campaign with the transforming enemies. Sometimes those guys just like transform after they've been blasted. I've seen one time I blasted one of them, one of the gun wielding enemies, like, man, they're the Juavo. But yeah, the Juavo. I like blasted him with a shotgun. He, in midair, as he was dying, transformed into one of those larger blobby like things and just exploded. I was just like, what? Seriously? He was right next to me, too, but. Yeah. There's also a problem with this game. As far as the in-game cutscenes go, the enemies continue to come at you and continue to attack you while cutscenes are going, while in-game cutscenes are going. And it can be really, really jarring, and that was a horrible shot. But yeah, it can be really jarring during segments. Especially later on in this level, you will see. I'll show you guys exactly where that's a huge problem, but it is a problem throughout this entire game. Like, sometimes you'll just have to watch them look at something or watch the characters like put a crank in somewhere or something, Like, it's not like they just put the crank in and then, you know, nothing happens and then you just have to hit the crank or something. It's like they put in the crank and then it shows, it's like spans around or pans around the room. And while that's happening, you're like getting shot up and stuff. And as soon as you get control back, your character's on the floor. It's absolutely ridiculous. But yeah, this section is pretty hazardous. I actually do like this little section though. It's a little tense. But it seems like they were trying to recreate those tense scenes in holy shite. I don't think she was damaged by that. Was that a dodge or did she get hit? But yeah, in these sort of sections in Leon's campaign, it seems like they were trying to recreate those sections in Resident Evil 4, where, you know, there were areas where you and Lewis, well, that one area where you and Lewis were inside of the cabin defending it, and that other area where you have to defend Ashley from all those Ganado things, in that giant main hallway room thing. I forgot what it was, but yeah. But yeah, it seems like they're trying to recreate that kind of thing. But the only problem with that is they do this too often in Leon's campaign. I never really noticed until I was trying to let them go damage it. Like doing like random test runs and stuff of the levels. But yeah, these guys you really need to watch out for. Again, I don't mind that these guys are kind of like invincible because they do have their little weak spot. And they do open themselves up to attack after a little while, but again, some of these other enemies are just absolutely ridiculous. See, and that is one of the scenes I was talking about. I could not move or anything, but I was still getting attacked. And zombies were still surrounding me. But yeah, that went really, really well, and I'm just like blathering on and on constantly. But I do enjoy the fact that there are other NPCs and stuff in this game. However, I wish that they were more distinct, and I wish that there were less of them so they didn't all look so generic. All these enemies, all these characters just look so low quality, in my opinion. I wish it was like the older games where, you know, you meet a few people, but they're pretty like distinct. And they actually have character and everything, like you get to know some of them. But in this one, it's just kind of like they're there. It's, I don't know, they don't really have any sort of lasting, they don't leave any lasting impression on you. But anyway, this section, again, it's trying to recreate like some of the stuff from the older games, but it just doesn't work because the older games weren't just single rooms where there's just like one puzzle and that's it. The older games were one giant puzzle, and my freaking controller is just being weird now. But I think the main problem with these Resident Evil games is that they segmented them into chapters as opposed to it being like one sprawling large map. Of course, I know Resident Evil 4 was segmented into chapters, but it sort of worked in that game a lot better than these, and that is one of the few things I didn't care for in Resident Evil 4 was that it was segmented into chapters. But yeah, it's just, if they were to create a Resident Evil game that was just like one large map that you had to explore, then I think we would be heading in more of a right direction for the series again. You know, use this new gameplay system, but give us a large sprawling map with a lot of puzzles that are all sort of connected to one another and stuff like that. And that's not something people really bring up when talking about the older, or talking about like revitalizing the series. They just mostly say, oh, I want horror back, I want horror, but, you know, there is a certain way. I mean, you can do horror in chapters, but I think it would be a lot better with just one giant map. Like it was in the older games. But yeah, in any case, enough blathering on about that. Okay, so in this little section, you will be attacked by the environment. There's a bunch of statues that try to shoot their crossbows at you, and you need to dodge the crossbow fire. But it's a little bit dicey. This one in particular is a little bit of a pain. But the thing you have to keep in mind when doing this is to use your invincibility frames, your advantage. I also suggest kind of waiting a few seconds depending upon which thing is about to fire at you so that you have invincibility frames.
Exactly. Wouldn't want to miss out on all the fun.
Yeah, I'll do that in a sec. So I'll have to hit this guy, run over here, wait a second because I've already been targeted, hit this, and you know, I was invincible during that fire. Or during that shot he took. But for the most part this isn't too bad, but you do have to sort of memorize where they come from so you can know where you're going. I do suggest for these later ones to kind of run in a little bit of a round shape as opposed to running straight toward them, because it does help you with dodging. Unless it's the very last one, like that guy was.
Nice.
Okay, I think we did it. Nope, she's still nice. Going. Alright, there we go. Again, these aren't really puzzles. I mean, I don't know why they really put this stuff here. If it's nothing like, it's not something that continuously shows up in the game. It's just like, hey, you know, you remember when this, you know, when you had to do things like this in the older games, except they were much harder. they were much more intricate in nature. Yeah, that was cool, right? But I don't know, I just see these as, like, it's just like padding the game out for no reason, because this isn't... Yes, it is! it's padding the game out, somewhat, but, well, it's not for no reason, I guess I see what she means. I mean, I know why they're padding the game out somewhat, but, it is just to pad the game out. Because, I mean, none of this is necessary. This isn't something that we do constantly throughout the game. This is just a one-time deal, and that's it. Just, I don't know. It's not like they're experimenting either, like with new gameplay mechanics or something like that, like in the Wonderful 101 where the gameplay completely changes at times. You can tell that they're experimenting with different ideas, and it fits into the world and stuff like that. And, you know, the original Devil May Cry with some of the different gameplay elements they used during certain sections, like first person and the flying battle at the very end of the game. But, I guess it's just to build atmosphere, but this isn't really a scary game.
And feel bad,
it's not a scary game whatsoever, in all honesty. But, I don't know. Again, Resident Evil Revelations did a much better job with the atmosphere and the little puzzles and stuff. But, excuse me for releasing the gas out of my throat.
Good job. Hope it was a door. Come on.
Alrighty, so now we are going to be fighting that bulbous monster that I was telling you guys about earlier. And you will see in a second how, I don't know, completely ineffectual gunfire is to it. And I'm going to be using a Magnum too, so, yeah. Actually, I might switch. I don't know what I'm going to do that.
Hey.
I think it's good to use a grenade, actually, too. Like, in the beginning. I don't know, we'll see. Alright. So of course this thing is transforming enemies into zombies. The problem with this enemy is just like it arches its back after it's been damaged a few times, but while its back is arched, it honestly does not seem like you're damaging it. It's really, really strange to me. It just seems like it's invincible completely.
Good job!
Oh, I almost attacked. So you definitely need to watch out for the miasma that it spews. That can damage you if you're really close, but since this is a larger room, you should be okay as long as you keep your distance. Definitely watch out for the zombies everywhere as well. The zombies can catch you by surprise very easily, since these are the NPCs that used to be in the room. But for some reason, they just continuously multiply. I mean, there's way more zombies in here than there were NPCs in here earlier. Unless there are people hidden in some random room or something like that, but I highly doubt that. So I think there is a way to save more of these NPC characters, like if you kill this thing faster, but I don't know, and that was a horrendous throw on my part. Absolutely horrendous. And again, thankfully, I'm not too close to it, or else I would have been damaged by that. Is it dead? No, it's stunned. She went to attack missions. Yeah, oh my god, get away from me. Jesus. Nice.
Good work.
Alright. Appreciate it. So that didn't go too badly, but now comes the hardest section of this level to complete. And yes, it is an absolute pain. Well, not the hardest section. The hardest section is after this section, but it does, you know, connect to the next section, so yeah. Thank you. More treasure, the better. But even with all this stated, like, even though it seems like I'm just completely, you know, shitting on the game, I do enjoy this game.
I think this panel and the numbers in the doors are
connected. It's just that this game could have been so much more than it was. But even so, I do enjoy aspects of it. The gameplay itself, if it was refined just a bit more, if they just, I don't know, just fix the feel a little bit. I think the characters feel a little too light. I think they went too much in the opposite direction, as opposed to having the tank-esque controls. They just went just too, I don't know. Just the characters are a little out of control sometimes. I just miss having that weight to my character. I like feeling a weight to my characters in these survival horror games, or sort of action slash horror-ish games. Like, you know, in Gears of War, like, you could move pretty quickly, but your character still felt like they had a weight. But in this game, it honestly doesn't feel like you have much weight to you, and in not having weight, it also doesn't feel like you're very powerful when you actually do melee attacks. Unless you do the actual finisher attacks, and something like that is what I'm talking about, where I was shooting that guy, a cutscene played, and while the cutscene was playing, he transformed into that and continued coming at me. And as you can see, they're still attacking her while she had to wait. I don't know why they did something like that, because in the older games, whenever like a cutscene like that would happen, all enemies would not be able to attack. I don't think they even moved or anything. And then once like the cutscene finished playing, then you were back in the same spot with the same enemies in the same place, so you weren't in for any surprises when you were giving back control. But in this game, you're just constantly surprised by what's happening once you get control back of your characters. It's just absolutely jarring to see. But again, I don't know, I still think this is a good game. I'd give this game a 7 out of 10. It is a failure. Like, as far as a horror game goes, it is the weakest of the main Resident Evil titles. And it was immensely disappointing, in all honesty, but just thinking objectively about what the game gives you, and just, like, the gameplay experience. I mean, they did try to do some new stuff here. They did give you a lot of scenarios to complete, but problem is, all the scenarios they give you just aren't polished enough. Leon's is probably the most polished of all of them, but still. Yeah, I don't know. Just could have been so much more. But, yeah, again, I thought they were gonna follow I thought this was gonna feel like an improved Resident Evil Revelations and that's one of the main reasons I was just really, really disappointed by this game, because Resident Evil Revelations got the feel down pretty well. Like, you still kind you had a weight to you, but your character was pretty maneuverable. They could dodge, and the atmosphere was really good and everything. And it just, oh, good. Thank goodness I was not damaged by that. I thought I was gonna be, but yeah, the atmosphere was really well done. The characters were maneuverable without being too light. And what is going on here? Jesus Christ. And yeah, I don't know. I just wish they would have went more toward that direction. I do like the melee system in this game somewhat, but I preferred shooting enemies in certain spots to be rewarded with melee attacks. I thought that was a really good incentive to keep you, you know, aiming the right way, and yeah, just playing really well. Because the game's essentially rewarded you for playing well. In this game, you're not really rewarded for playing well. There are a lot of random factors in Resident Evil 6 when you're trying to do, you know, serious runs, whatever that means. But, you know, a run like this, it's nothing like doing Resident Evil 4, where, you know, you can methodically complete that game with your skill alone. But this one definitely takes a little bit of luck, to say the least, especially in scenes like that, where you just lose control of your character and you have to watch something, and you're placed into a situation that you weren't in before the cutscene played. But, yeah, so this is the hardest section of this level, and it is such a pain, you guys have no idea. And oh my god, someone sent me a text. I'm sorry about that. I have to edit that out. Jesus Christ. I apologize. But, yeah. So again, little mini section where I lose control of my character, but zombies are still pouring into that little section of the room that we're in. As you can see, that zombie was right next to me. Jesus. Again, it's something that you have to prepare for, like, beforehand, like placing your characters in certain spots during certain cutscenes and things like that, when you know a cutscene's gonna play, so that they aren't just completely screwed once you get control back. I just also don't like how I know exactly where enemies are gonna be spawning from and stuff like that. I think the spawn points in this game are badly done. The game almost feels arcadey in a lot of ways because of it. Oh my god, are you serious? I have a shotgun, you stupid wench. Again, something I was talking about earlier. Shotgun blasts from that close will blow you back no matter what. I don't care. I do not care. If you're a zombie, I don't care. You should have flown back. See if I was far away from you, but Jesus. And again, this is something they got right in the earlier games. Resident Evil 5 does this, Resident Evil Revelations does this, but geez, even Operation Raccoon City, the shotgun pushes back zombies. God freaking darn it. But, yeah, this section just pisses me off with these elevators. So right now we are just taking out like anything that we see, because we know that we are going to have to be dealing with the little cutscene thing that we have no control over. And of course zombies continuously pouring into the room and stuff like that. But again, as I was saying, it's just so obvious where the spawn points are. It's just like zombies coming out of vacuous air ducts. That, like, these air ducts that continuously spawn these things, and it's just, why did they make the spawn point so obvious? And I wish that the spawns weren't infinite the way they are. It's just, I don't know. Just not good, not good at all. I like being able to kill all enemies in an area and then move on, but in this game, that's practically impossible. It's just really, really irritating. But, yeah. What she's doing is killing all the enemies around her, because once she pulls a switch over there, oh my god, that was not good. But Yeah, once she pulls a switch over there, one of those weird sort of pink fleshy zombies pops out. There he is. And he lunges at her as soon as the cutscene ends. So like he's already like right next to her once that cutscene ends. So she has like no time to react to it. Almost no time. If it was her first playthrough, she'd have like no time to react. But since she was ready for it, she was able to dodge it. But even when she's ready for it, every so often she does get hit by it, which is a real pain. But yeah, that's just bad game design. Absolutely terrible game design right there. I just don't like it when you're forced to take damage in video games. I do think all damage should be avoided or avoidable in a video game. And look at this, like, zombies just right next to me now. There was nothing in here earlier, and now they're just right here. But yeah, I freaking drilled that point into the ground already, so I will stop with that. But as I was saying, I just don't like it when I'm forced to take damage. No, I don't mind if it's like a story sequence cutscene and, you know, your character loses their health and stuff like that. It's like, you know, part of the storyline. Couldn't think of the word that I was thinking of, but yeah. I don't mind if it's like part of the actual narrative itself and then your character takes damage and then you have to, you know, continue on. Sort of like, you know, Metal Gear Solid where you're in a torture chamber and, you know, you have to take damage and all that, but stuff like this, it's not your fault at all. It's just so irritating. I should not be penalized for playing the game well. It just doesn't make sense to me. Just bad game design, in my opinion. Just bad. But yeah, like I don't mind if you have to like walk into like smoldering lava or something at some point in the game, you know, and you take a little bit of damage from that, because that's not real damage to me. You know, stuff like Dark Souls, where, you know, you have to traverse like a lava-filled area or area with poison, stuff like that. That's fine. It's toxic, whatever. It makes sense. But as long as I can avoid all damage from enemies, I'm fine. But if I can't avoid all enemy damage for one reason or another, without thematic elements being in play, then there's something wrong with the game design, in my view. Alrighty, so we are sliding down this chute here, and there's not much more to go in this level. We do have a boss battle coming up, but in my opinion, it's a pretty good boss battle. It's not my favorite boss battle in the game, though. I think my favorite boss battle in this game is in Chapter 4 of Leon's campaign, as well as Chris's final boss. I don't know, I really like that final boss, but the section itself can be a pain sometimes. There's nothing in Jake's campaign that I actually really like, so to hell with that. I guess I do like the section where you are in like the ice caverns or whatever, and you have to avoid the enemy that's kind of like lingering around the corners and stuff. That was pretty cool. Kind of reminded me of Clock Tower and stuff like that. I wish his whole campaign was like that. It's just kind of like a stealth-esque system, but instead it just turned into a freaking action movie. Just like those sections are way few and far between. Way too few and far between. It's just really disappointing. They could have did a lot more with that, because we already have our action stuff with Chris. We didn't need it with Jake as well. Deborah! Alright, so we are coming up soon on the boss battle. Not quite yet, because we don't know that Deborah is going to be infected. Spoilers. For anyone who doesn't want to know the story, or does want to know the story, whatever. Deborah. All right. So in this section, I kind of have to protect my partner somewhat. Since she's carrying her sister, she can't use a gun or anything. All she can do is melee attack, if I remember correctly. So let's continue on, and we're almost done with this level. The actual boss battle is not hard, so I think I should be good for the rest of the level as far as not taking damage. I don't think there's any attack that the boss has that Leon has to take damage in any sort of way. So I should be good. Alright, so there are a bunch of zombies throughout this section. Again, you should take them out if you're playing as Leon so that your partner can have an easier time getting through here. Even if you don't, I don't think it's too hard for you to navigate through here if you're playing as Helena.
The roof is caving in.
But I think it is a bit of a pain, no matter what. What is she asking for help about? Jesus. Something that I just absolutely do miss in Revelations and Resident Evil 6 is just item management, at least ammo management, because yeah, it's pretty much non-existent in this game. This game, you pretty much want to hold as much ammo as you possibly can for every single weapon, or at least for your favorite weapons. I kind of wish that we could put away certain guns instead of having to hold every single gun. I don't know, just miss having a real inventory. But again, what do I know? I know nothing. I know nothing of game design. But yeah, I like these caverns, and that was really close. The projectile vomit that the zombies shoot at you is absolutely ridiculous. No way can they have that kind of accuracy with projectile vomit. I'm sorry, no way.
These walkways won't hold.
All right.
I need to get to the lower levels. I'm so sorry, Debra.
So this isn't the boss battle just yet.
Get away from her.
But once this cutscene finishes, you are gonna want to dodge because she is gonna swing it at you. So, yeah. And Ada didn't listen to my advice. I don't know if she got damaged or what just happened. I don't know if that was supposed to happen. I don't remember. Well, either way, we're gonna make our way down here. And then we are going to actually fight the boss. I do like this section a lot.
Debra, where
it's pretty
you?
Cool. Alright. I have heard that a lot of people like Ada's campaign the most. And I put Ada's campaign a little above Jake's, and that is not a very good compliment whatsoever. I actually detest Ada's campaign in a variety of ways, but yeah, we'll get to that point when we get to it. I will not be doing a no damage of Ada's. Actually, it might be possible though, I'm not sure. Again, it's just all speculation on my part at this point. I need to replay through her campaign. I'm pretty sure it's not. I don't know, maybe it is. Who knows? Ada, get yourself over here.
Watch out, you two! She's strong!
Watch out.
Okay. So this boss is actually pretty easy. The only thing you really need to watch out here for are the zombies themselves that just spawn out of nowhere at times. Everything else is relatively simple about her. Just follow her when she's jumping around. She'll jump all over the area. If your sensitivity is not fast enough to follow her, just up your sensitivity. I don't see why it wouldn't be, but... In any case, I like to use the sniper rifle against her. And once she gets damaged enough, she'll do that. One of those things will come out of her head, and you just bash it. And that QTE is always the same, so you'll always have to hit the right bumper or R1 at the very end of that sequence. Or R2, I don't know, I don't know. Whichever button you guys use for a trigger. You do need to watch out for that lunge attack she has, though. Just try to completely destroy you with it. Yeah, again, pretty simple boss, but I do enjoy it quite a bit. That was a pretty good dodge, if I do say so myself. And again, she's really easy to follow when she's jumping around. But whenever you see her get staggered and just fall off, she's usually about to do this, so you can just run in and do your melee attacks. Alright, so I'm pretty sure she's about to be dead, so let's use our Magnum against her. There we go. Sweet. Okay. So now for the end sequence of the boss battle. Well, that was the actual boss battle. The rest of it is just like an escape sequence.
Elena, a little help here?
A little reminiscent to Resident Evil 4 again with the cart kind of thing, but again, it's... I don't know. I really like it, but I don't think it's as good as Resident Evil 4's cart thing. And that was a little close. I was afraid of getting damaged by the fire. Did not want that to happen at this point. Okay. So, just keep running after Ada and Helena's little elevator thing. Actually, you can run much past it, but I'm kind of slowing down a bit because there's a lot of debris that falls from the ceiling area, so you cannot be damaged by that. Or you can be damaged by that, if I remember correctly. I think you can die if you're under it. Maybe. I'm not sure. I don't want to find out, so I'll be cautious. So over here, you're going to have to crank. And I shouldn't have done that, because that guy's already holding fire. Should have just blasted him. Oh, whatevs.
Good work.
Alright, let's get rid of this. Because I want more grenades. More important than pistol shots. Also, for anyone who doesn't know, if you wiggle both analog sticks, and my controller's just being weird, but if you spin both analog sticks, this will go faster, the QTE things. Alright. So let's get ready for the final sequence.
All aboard! Not too shabby!
Let's hope this is a non-stop ride out of here.
Alright, let's do this.
I wouldn't count on it.
You can use the little QTEs that pop up, or you can just bend under these if you want. Which is aim, hold down the aim button, and then hit the action button, I guess. The A or the X button on the PlayStation 3.
Just stop it, Debra! This isn't you!
Not too shabby!
Thanks!
Alright. So she will continuously attack you while you're on the minecart. She's really easy to avoid. I'm not really sure if actually shooting her really does anything, but I shoot her anyway just because, and my controller is going crazy right now.
Don't you think I know that?
What is happening? Alright. There we go. Again, she will do horizontal swipes, and she will do vertical ones as well. Obviously, watch out for the vertical ones if you are on the floor. And God, my controller is losing it. What is happening? Yeah. So I wasn't doing a lot of that stuff that was going on there. I don't know why. Controller is being really odd at times. At times it does that. When I connect it to my PC, I don't know why. Just don't understand. It just glitches out every so often. So I apologize for that, but in any case, I still survived, so that's what matters. So if you don't want to actually dodge anything here, you can just stay on the floor. Makes things much easier. I have no idea what that was, though. One QTE.
Thanks.
Okay, so I think she does return in a little bit for like one last sequence. Alright, here we go. Alright, there goes the vertical strike, but either way, we're done with that. So now right here, I don't bother saving Ada because I have a Magnum, so I'm just gonna shoot Deborah and just be done with the mission. And there we go. God darn controller, stop it! You stop it! Stop it, controller. Jeez. Alright, so let's hope we have an S rank, and if we do, that will be it. And yes, we do! So this is the video I will upload. Hope that you guys enjoyed it, and I will see you in Chapter 3 of Resident Evil 6, No Damage, No Hope playthrough.